Valor Ministries, Voices and Love, Offering Redemption, presents Right on Time.
And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, Who hath told thee that thou wast naked?
I want you to remember the last part of that scripture. Who told you that you were naked? Now our responsive reading, which we will find in the book of Proverbs, and it will be chapter 2, the first 22 verses. This responsive reading is split up into six stanzas. At the end of each stanza, my Pastor Desiree will raise her hand. It's hard to not call her my mom. Pastor Desiree will raise her hand, and we will have a response, which is, only the Lord gives true salvation. Reverend Ezra?
I must say that mine is not broken in the same place as yours is broken.
Then wherever you decide that it is, raise your hand and we will respond.
Thank you.
My son, if thou wilt receive my words and hide my commandments with thee, so that thou might incline thine ear unto wisdom, and apply thine heart unto understanding. Yea, if thou criest after knowledge, and liftest up thy voice for understanding, if thou seekest her as silver, and searchest for her as for hid treasures, then shalt thou understand the fear of the Lord, and find the knowledge of God.
Only the Lord gives true salvation.
For the Lord gives wisdom. Out of his mouth comes knowledge and understanding. He lays up sound wisdom for the righteous. He is a buckler for them who walk uprightly. He keeps the paths of judgment and preserves the way of his saints.
Only
the Lord gives true salvation.
Then shalt thou understand righteousness and judgment and equity, yea, every good path. When wisdom enters into thine heart, and knowledge is pleasant unto thy soul, discretion shall preserve thee, understanding shall keep thee, to deliver thee from the way of the evil man, from the man that speaketh froward things. Who leave the paths of uprightness to walk in the ways of darkness. Who rejoice to do evil and delight in the frowardness of the wicked.
Only the Lord gives true salvation.
Whose ways are crooked and they froward in their paths. To deliver thee from the strange woman, even from the stranger which flattereth her with words. Which forsaketh the guide of her youth, and forgetteth the covenant of her God. For her house inclineth unto death, and her paths unto the dead.
Only the Lord gives true salvation.
none that go unto her return again, neither taketh they hold of the paths of life. That thou mayest walk in the way of good men, and keep the paths of the righteous. For the upright shall dwell in the land, and the perfect shall remain in it. But the wicked shall be cut off from the earth, and the transgressors shall be rooted out of it.
Only the Lord gives true salvation.
And Reverend Ezra, I'd like you to read that last verse once again.
But the wicked shall be cut off from the earth, and the transgressors shall be rooted out of it.
So remember this verse and the first one, who told you you were naked. And now, our New Testament reading, if you would stand in honor of the resurrection of Christ and the New Testament that has been given. We're going to be reading from the book of Ephesians, the second chapter, the first 7 verses.
And you hath he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in time past you walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now worketh in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past, in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, as were others. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace ye are saved. And he hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. And that is the reading of the Word of God this morning.
Blessed be the Lord God. Amen. You may be seated, except for Brother Stewart. Stewart, if you'd make your way to the lectern. Brother Stewart is an ordained Assembly of God pastor, goes to Auburn Hills Christian Center. He's befriended me. And he has an unusual sense of humor, which not everyone gets, but he makes me belly laugh. And he's the hardest working man at one thing, telling people about Jesus Christ. He does Uber, however you pronounce it. And he calls that his mobile chat. Everyone that gets in his cab knows about Jesus before they get out, without exception. And I asked him to come greet us before we do the sermon this morning. Brother Stewart.
You know, let's turn to Psalms 127. That's in the Old Testament, right?
Sister Deborah had everything marked, and so I got a hunch. I would have read it before. Psalm 127. Except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. Except the Lord keep the city, the watchman waketh but in vain. Is there any doubt in your mind that the Lord built this house?
No.
There's none. Those who labored to bring this to you did not labor in vain. Except the Lord keep the city. Now, in the New American Standard, it says, unless the Lord guard the city. Do you have any doubt that God is keeping and guarding the city of Pontiac? Is there any doubt?
Yes.
No, sir.
There is no doubt. The watchman who spent the evening, midnight hours on their knees for Pontiac did not spend that time in prayer in vain. Because I am telling you that God is stirring the waters.
Amen.
In the city of Pontiac. Who's going to be the first one to jump in? Praise. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Give the Lord praise offering.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. This is our inaugural service. So your pastor gets to take a little liberty. Some of you know that I do some secular entertaining. I'm a Sinatra fan. I'm a big Sinatra fan. I love the old standards. So I sing a little. So you'll all bear with me. Is it all right? My congregation is used to this song, but it's an appropriate song this Sunday morning. So if you'll bear with me, I'm going to sing a song.
Praise God. This morning's sermon, but God. How many of you have ever seen the Robert De Niro movies, Analyze This and Analyze That? There's a famous scene where Billy Crystal's saying to De Niro, doesn't anyone ever tell you no? Well, yeah, all the time, but it's usually, no, no, no! But God! Usually the only time we say, but God, is when he calls us to do something, and we go, but God, wait a minute! That's not this. This is, but God. I was born and raised here, but for over half my life, I lived in Chicago. Part of my heart's still there. I love the city. And in Chicago, there's a very famous church called Moody Bible Church. Moody Radio all over the world. D.L. Moody was an old country preacher. He would butcher and massacre the King's English. But he knew how to preach salvation. I'm going to tell you this morning that for years, you know, I've been an evangelist. And I preach evangelistically, and I got a good set of messages for that. I've had to learn to write pastoral messages because this pastor didn't want to be a pastor. But God had other ideas. Because when he called me, I went, but God, but God. And in fact, my church knows the story, but I was sitting in another church, and a young preacher was preaching on a topic that I had no interest in. And I heard God call me, and there was another preacher sitting in front of me, and I said to God, but God, he's right there in front of me, like he was lost. And realized that he knew who he was talking to. And that was a year and 3 weeks ago. And that man that I said was in front of me was here early this morning praying for us. And I said it was his fault because he didn't answer, and I did. Brother D.L. Moody had a number of pastors that he trained through the years. All of them all seemed to have initials. H.A. Ironside, R.A. Torrey, L.D. Lupin. I mean, they don't seem to have first names. But D.L. Moody was on a train in downtown Chicago, and they have a train system that actually works. And he was riding in this L train, and a gypsy woman sat down beside him, not knowing that it was D.L. Moody, and said, sir, if you'd cross my palm with a little silver, in other words, if you'll pay me, I'll tell you your future. D.L. Moody said, before you do that, let me show you what God says about my future. And he reached in his pocket and opened his Bible, which incidentally he happened to have with him. And she said, that's okay. I see that Bible. I've had quite enough. He grabbed her arm and stated quite clearly, no, I want you to hear this. Past guilt, he said. She yelled, quite enough, preacher, quite enough. He continued, present grace. I said, that's quite enough. And he continued, future glory. Amen. Now screaming, she again said, it's enough. And she broke away, free of his grip, ran down the length of the train crying out, I picked the wrong man, I picked the wrong man. That was the most false thing she did. She had picked the right man. She didn't want to hear the message. Let me tell you, you can call Madame Zonga, Dionne Warwick, the psych, well, they call it the psychiatric friends or the psychic, I call them the psychotic friends network. If you want to, but when it comes to your future, I prefer the word of God. Amen. I've had to learn to write pastoral sermons, and I'm going to say something. I don't mean this arrogantly. Please take it the right way. This is the best pastoral sermon I've ever written, and you're going to find out why. I want to go back to the basics this morning. All of this external beauty that you see around, and it's breathtaking. And the robes that I wear, which some seamstress took, I'm sure, days
to put together don't count for a thing if we don't go back to the basic of God's holy word.
Amen.
So here we go. First basic truth. Salvation exists in the past. Salvation exists in the present. And salvation exists in the future. Being saved is not a Baptist thing. It's not a Methodist thing. It's not a Catholic thing. It's not even a Pentecostal thing. It's a God thing.
Amen.
It's also not a term that we made up in the church. As Gomer Pyle would say, surprise, surprise, surprise. It's actually a Bible term. No other name given under heaven among men whereby we must be
saved.
Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be
saved.
Right out of the Bible. This morning I want to truly start with the basic and ask you the most important question that you've ever been asked. Boy, that's big, isn't it? You've been asked a lot of questions in your life. It's so simple, yet so complex. Here's the question. Have you been saved? Has anyone ever asked you that question? We declare that we are. But has someone asked you that question? Have you been saved? How do you know? Some of you declare it, but how do you know? This morning, I want you to stop for a second. Put into the words yourself, speak to yourself right now, and answer the question, how do you know? Take a moment. Wait a minute, preacher, you're making me do something? Yeah. You're not here just to listen to my big voice. How do you know? Now, in that answer, did it start with a sentence that I, or did it start with a sentence of God? This morning, let me state that salvation is only of the Lord Jesus Christ. Too many people are trying to save themselves. Look at the world and how messed up it is. Trying to earn it. Trying to be good enough. It's not about us. It's about God. Two of the most precious words in all of our scripture are in the fourth verse in our New Testament reading this morning. And even my mother couldn't get through it without saying it. But God. Psalm 49 and 15. But God will redeem my soul from the power of the grave, for he shall receive me. Mark 2 and 7. Who can forgive sins?
But God.
But God only. Luke 16 and 15. And he said unto them, ye are they which justify yourselves before men.
But God.
But God knoweth in your hearts. Romans 5 and 8.
But God
commendeth his love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for who?
Not us.
1 Corinthians 3 and 6. I have planted, Apollos watered,
but God
gave the increase. You're all awake this morning. So then neither is he that planteth anything, neither he that watereth,
but God
gives the increase. Ephesians 2 and 4.
But God,
who is rich in mercy for his great love wherein he loved us. The Bible doesn't say, but you. It says,
but God.
In the beginning of man, in the Garden of Eden, we read it this morning, Adam and Eve sinned. We don't think about that, do we? They lost their innocence. He realized they were naked and tried to cover it. Now, this is a picture of man trying to cover his own sinfulness. They'd eaten at the end of the day. Christ walked with them in the cool of the day. That meant morning, if it were in our English. So they'd eaten this in the evening, and it's the way it's inferred that the serpent sort of stayed around all night. Here's God's creation, and they spent the night trying to figure out what they were going to tell God in the morning. And what they come up with? Fig leaves. Good boy. Sort of like when we were teenagers and the first night we weren't home when we were supposed to be home. And boy, we were scrambling for that lie. Thinking our parents would believe it because, you know, they hadn't done anything like that. I'm not talking to anybody in this building, am I? God came along and shed the blood of an innocent animal that day and clothed them with skin of it. This is the first demonstration of blood being shed for sin and the innocent dying for us, the guilty. Are you trying to cover yourself? You can't do it. Our righteousness is as filthy rags. This morning, underneath your fine clothes, are you wearing fig leaves? I sure hope not. Baptism, confirmation, church attendance, tithing and donating offerings, good works, keeping the Ten Commandments. I'm a good person. Mommy told me I'm saved. No, but God, not my baptism, not my confirmation, not my church attendance, not my tithes and offerings, not my good works, not my keeping the Ten Commandments, not by being a good person, and definitely not because your mommy told you so. Salvation is of the Lord only. You cannot save yourself. You may as well try and blow back a hurricane with a house fan, or dam up Niagara Falls with toothpicks. It's futile. My question this morning is one, who saves? God! God alone. Two, why does God save us? Love and mercy. It's so hard to understand the depths of his love that it's beyond our understanding. It's so easy to love someone who's lovable, loving and lovely. But God loved us while we were yet sinners. I know most of you in this building, and I'm lucky enough to call a lot of you my friends, and you love me. But 11 years ago, I was a thug, a drunk, a drug addict, an immoral, words I won't repeat, we have children and we're in the house of the Lord. I was unlovable! And yet now you hear me preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. Why? Not because of anything I did, but because of the love and mercy of Jesus Christ. We may not totally understand it, but oh Lord, let's thank God for it. A hymn writer by the name of P.P. Bliss wrote many hymns, including, "Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me." He was a teenage boy when he wrote that hymn. He wrote it at a very young age. Then later in life, he wrote this hymn, "I am so glad that my Father in heaven tells me of his love in the book he has given." When he had become mature in the Lord, he was suddenly impressed by God's love. My mother went to a school up in Maine in the beginning of her theological training. The Reverend Peer, he was the most conservative preacher I ever met in my life. I wasn't sure that he even bended when he sat down. He was so conservative. He was a great theologian, a lot like our associate pastor. Boy, not right with not him sitting over there. I don't like this. He was teaching at the seminary, and many of the students, including my mother, came to him after a lecture and said, "We'd like to know the most profound truth that's ever occupied your mind." Now that's a good question to ask a theologian, isn't it? They stood with bated breath, expecting some deep doctrine. I love his answer. He said, "Great doctrine was on my mother's knee whenever she sang, 'Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so.'" That was the deepest doctrine he knew. Amen. Why does God save us? Because he loves us. Amen. And why does God love us? Here's the most honest statement I'm ever going to tell you. I honestly don't know! We're unlovable! A preacher that doesn't know something, write that down. It's a miracle morning. The Bible says, because of his mercy. Amen. And what is mercy? Mercy is not receiving the punishment that we rightfully deserve. You know, like when you got out of the ticket that you deserved. Mercy getting out of the punishment you so rightly deserve.
It's a funny story about a lady who went to the photographer some later years. Said to the photographer, please do me justice. The photographer told her she didn't need justice, she needed mercy. Yeah. Mercy is not receiving the punishment we rightly deserve. And what is it we so rightly deserve? You're not going to like the answer. I'm going to be labeled a bigot, a fairy tale spreader, an old-fashioned and out-of-date preacher, a hater, and a preacher who's going to make you feel uncomfortable and unsafe in your worship service. Well, the last statement is true. What is the punishment each and every one of us deserve? Death and hell. Preacher, what are you doing? What are you doing? This is the inaugural service, the grand opening. This isn't the time to mention death and hell. I told you at the very beginning of this sermon I was going back to the basics. Back to the very foundations of the scripture. If you tell yourself the biggest lie ever and convince yourself that you've only committed one sin in your whole life, first I want to meet you. But if that was true, God still wouldn't allow you into heaven. Let me unequivocally state right here, right now, heaven is not a state of mind. It's not a state of being. It's a very real place. And we, that's us, are made perfect by accepting the blood of Jesus for the forgiveness of our sins. In other words, being saved. Even if you only had one sin. We're all painfully aware of what sinners we are. But some of us this very morning don't believe we can be saved because of all that we've done. Let me tell you, I was the chief among sinners, as Paul said. And yet here I stand proclaiming forgiveness and salvation. You can still be saved no matter what you've done. This is the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You can escape death and hell this very morning. I heard the story of a poor woman from the slums of Detroit taken on a holiday by her friends to the Atlantic Ocean. When she arrived, she just sat there frozen and gazing out over the water. She started crying, and her friends were bewildered as to why on such a beautiful day. She then said, it's the first thing I've ever seen that there's enough of. Mm-hmm. Let me go back to the basics of why we started this church in particular. Now located in this amazing building in downtown Pontiac, Michigan. You know what it is? It's to shout from the rooftop, from the top of this pulpit, from the streets, from the restaurants, from the businesses, and in the public square, that there's enough mercy in God's little finger to wipe every sin that's ever been committed in this city. Amen. Who saves? God alone. Why? I don't understand why, except he tells of his love and his mercy. And here, how does God save? By grace. Not love alone. Otherwise, we could constantly state, as many of our millennial folks do in this present age, I believe in a God of love that would never send anyone to hell. Then if someone tells you that, run. Run. John 3:16 proves what I'm about to say. For God so loved the world. You say, see, there's the love. That he gave his only begotten son. Then, here's this next word. That whosoever believeth. We have to choose. Remember, grace is receiving something good that you don't deserve. It won't be much longer. We're going to have to fix the heat. I know it's hot in here. But we're escaping hell. So this is as hot as you're going to be. Grace. I have a great acronym for this. So those who take notes. God's redemption at Christ's expense. Pastor, what is it that God gives us that we don't deserve? Here it is. Eternal life in heaven with him. And what makes that possible? The righteousness of Jesus Christ. We're not only saved from something, but to something. Not only are we saved from sin, forgiven, but we become recipients of Christ's righteousness, clothed in his very righteousness. It's imputed righteousness. I don't live very righteous sometimes. It's not imparted. That's what we call sanctification or positional. I'm getting off the basics. God looks at the saved, born again Christian and sees not just a forgiven sinner, but a justified one. Just as if I'd never sinned. That's grace. Who saves? God alone. How does God save? By grace, through faith. Next, when does God save? When true biblical faith occurs. Notice it doesn't say we are saved by faith. We are saved by grace through faith. We're saved by grace, and faith is the vehicle that gets us there. Faith, another acronym, forsaking all, I trust him. Too many people have missed salvation because they trust in Christ plus something else. True biblical faith is Jesus Christ plus nothing. 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 You can't earn your way there. It's not possible. Now, you're all sitting on a pew with one leg, well, some are in the chairs, with one leg on it and one on the floor. Say that you were doing that. You had one leg up on it and one on the floor. Are you trusting the pew? Yeah, part of you is, but part of you is trusting the floor. The example is just like trusting Christ plus baptism, plus good works, plus coming to church, plus tithing, plus my mommy told me. It's just Christ plus nothing. Amen. Don't think you'll make it there on your own. The grand old hymn I sang this morning wasn't how great I am. It was how great thou art. You have to trust in Jesus alone and believe in his death in your place, his blood in your stead, and his resurrection so that he can actually prepare a place for you. All of these basics this morning would be a complete and total waste of time if he hadn't got out of that tomb, resurrected after 3 days from death and hell. In and of yourself, you cannot make it to heaven. This morning, I want you to realize you need salvation. Can be saved because of Jesus Christ. You say, man, this is an old-time message, Pastor. Most of us are Christians. Sometimes we need to go back to our foundation. Who saves? God alone. By love and mercy. How does God save? By grace through faith. When does God save? When true biblical faith occurs. And in closing this morning, I ask one final question. Where does that leave you? I'm not the smartest guy in the world, but I'm not the dumbest either. Has raised is what the scripture says. Is that future or is it already taking place? Ephesians 1 and 3, I'm going to read it to you. Praise be to God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. Guess what? If we are saved, we're already in the heavenly realms. We're already there. Do you know where you're going? I'm going to heaven. Amen. But most people say, well, I hope so. Well, if you're saved, you're already there. If you're not, before this day is through, you got the chance. Good to know, because it means I can view every circumstance of life from a heavenly perspective. We hear the question all the time, almost every day, how you doing today? And what's one of the most common answers? Well, good, under circumstances. God doesn't want you to live under circumstances. Get out from underneath there. He wants us to view it all from a higher perspective. What do our circumstances matter next to eternity? Your salvation has a present tense. You might have hard circumstances, and some of you in this place today are going through that storm. But God, down in the dumps, stop it. You're in the heavenlies. You may think you're pretty low, and it may appear Satan has you by the throat sometimes. But God has you somewhere else. Where? In the heavenlies. Now let's have fun. Genesis 31:7. And your father hath deceived me and changed my wages 10 times.
But God.
Suffered him not to hurt me. Genesis 48:21. And Israel said unto Joseph, Behold, I die.
But God
shall be with you. Genesis 50:20. But as for you, ye thought evil against me.
But God
meant it unto good. 1 Samuel 23:14. And David abode in the wilderness in strongholds, and remained in a mountain in the wilderness of Ziph. And Saul sought him every single day.
But God
delivered him not into his hand. 2 Chronicles 20:15. And he said, Hearken ye all Judah, inhabitants of Jerusalem, and thou King Jehoshaphat. Michelle sing about him last Sunday. Thus saith the Lord unto you, Be not afraid, nor dismayed by the reason of this great multitude. For the battle is not yours,
but God's.
Psalm 64:7.
But God.
He shall shoot at them with an arrow. Suddenly they shall be wounded. Psalm 73:26. See the theme here? My flesh and heart faileth,
but God
is the strength of my heart and my portion forever. 1 Corinthians 10:13. There hath no temptation taken you, but such is common to man.
But God
is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above ye that are able, but will with the temptation make a way to escape, and you'll be able to bear it. Philippians 2:27. For indeed he was sick nigh unto death,
but God
had mercy on him, and not only on him, but upon me also. Who saves? God alone. Why? Love and mercy. How does God save? By grace through faith. When does God save? When you choose to accept him as Savior. Through biblical time. What does that leave us? In heavenly places. Lord, thank you for the simplicity of your salvation. You cannot face God someday, and you will face him, with anything less than Jesus as your Savior. You cannot save yourself. No ifs, ands, or
but.
What? But God. Many of you are my friends and have come to help celebrate us. You say, man, my salvation. I want every single person that you talk to, what did he preach on for his opening service? Salvation, but God! I want everyone that asks you to be able to you give the answer that he's preaching salvation in downtown Pontiac. He's saying to those men that are sitting on that bench Monday through Friday, and they are, just ask those that have been working here, what's their answer? But God! Amen. What was the answer for you? But God. And we get so busy with the busy work of our life that sometimes we forget that simple principle. It's but God. For those of you that are trying to work your way or heaven or think you need all that other stuff, do you need church attendance? God says, forsake not the assembly. Have yourself here. Do you need to tithe? He said 10% of it's his. Do you need to give offerings? Sure. Do you need to be baptized? Yes. Do you need the Holy Spirit? Yes. That's so that you can live a successful life, but none of that gets you into heaven.
That's right.
Only salvation. Right. Now, what do you think comes next? For all of you that know God, boy, I'm glad. But maybe this is the day that you rededicate. Maybe this is the day that you once again say, hey, Lord, I've been in it so long that maybe it's become formative. Have a time this morning to say, let me get back on track, God. I'm trying to work my way there and go back to just but God. Let us pray. My dear Father, pastor of this cathedral, my spirit couldn't be any happier. I'm leaping this day at what you've given us, just so beyond my imagination. God, if I ever quit preaching anything besides you and you crucified, take it away from me. Lord, all the people sitting in this sanctuary this morning came to celebrate with us. I'm so grateful for every one of them. Bless them, Lord. What I have is blessing and favor. Lord, I give them favor this morning.
But right now, I want them to take a moment and ask that question. One, do they know you as Savior? Have they ever prayed that prayer? Where on their knees, they said, Lord, save me. And Lord, even if they are, for a moment, let them reevaluate their life and make sure that they're serving you with biblical foundation. Lord, I love you. I pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Sister Michelle is going to come sing us a song. What number? Once she's through with that song, I'm going to play an old chorus just as I am. And I'm going to open these altars. Those who need salvation, come see me. Those who want to rededicate, see me. Those that are sick, let me pray for you. Those that have special needs that you've called me about or talked to me, let me pray with you this morning. I know we've gone over a little, but it's a grand opening, so it's a little extra time this morning. But let us not go out of here without prayer. Is that okay? But
God.
Sister Michelle, please come bless us.
Lose when you could win.
Everyone in peace. Everyone saved. Everyone prays. Proud of you. Matthew, I'm proud of you. You don't know it this day, but you just made the best decision you've ever made in your whole life. And see all these people around you? We're now your brothers and sisters. We love you, young Matthew. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Anyone feel like they came to church this morning?
Amen.
Good. It's time for our final hymn. We have a tradition here. We have a song called God Be With You Till We Meet Again. We sing the first verse together, and then it goes right into the second verse. It's white hymnal, page 20. And in the second verse, only you songbirds of the female persuasion sing, and us old frogs shut up. And then on the third verse, we frogs sing. And then on the fourth verse, we play it together. Shall we sing, God be with you, till we meet again?
God be with you till we meet again. By the tassels that uphold you, with his sheep securely fold you. God be with you till we meet again.
Church.
My death's threatening way before.